Oops, clean up on aisle three. That pile right there will probably financially put me under. I'll have to declare Chapter 7 bankruptcy over that one, I think. It's a beautiful Monday morning. Probably the last day this week I will be wearing shorts, though, because it's supposed to turn cold. All right, what I've got to do? Oh, darn it. I don't think I parked close enough. I've got to put fuel in the machine here. And I don't know if my hose is long enough, so let me get closer. The story of my life. My hose is never long enough. I'm sure you've heard the expression that things happen in threes. So last week I had those two electric motors that I was dealing with, and I needed one more because things happen in three. Well, sure enough, yesterday afternoon when I went down to the farm to transfer fuel out of my tanks, one tank I emptied. This still wasn't full. Went to the second tank, turned the pump on, nothing. Tripped the breaker at the outlet. Pulled the pump apart, looked at everything inside. I didn't see anything that was out of sync or that should have been sparking or arcing. Put it all back together, reset the power supply, plugged it in, hit the switch, same thing. Trips the breaker again. I think my fuel pump has finally bit the dust and it's not going to give me any more fuel. So I got 250 gallons of fuel in there that I can't get out. So I'm looking for a new pump now. I did find a hand crank pump in the shop, so I guess I can use that until I find another pump. But my God, those gas pumps have gone up in price tremendously. To get one with a gauge on it, it's like $1,500 or $1,600 to have the fuel gauge counter on it. Holy crap. So I've only got about 25 gallons in here to put in the machine, but with what I already have in there, that will get me through the day. We'll see where that ends up. It's going to be a Monday. I can already tell that. Last week, I did put a new sensor on here, but it's not lining up. So if you recall, this chain, when I replaced it, I did not put the master link in correctly. It came off. It made a heck of a mess. So it took this sensor here out. So I finally got a new sensor. This little doodad right here, little metal clip that holds that sensor in there, $19 freaking for that. Holy crap. But it's not lining up with that sprocket there. So I've got to see if I can move this sprocket over. So yeah, right there, looks like there's two jam nut set screws there. So I can slide that over and hopefully get that registering. So let me do that. All right, I think it's finished pumping here. Hey, have I? Well, damn it, I can't get this on here. There we go. I don't do much screwing these days. Have I mentioned I don't have to put government juice in this thing? Let's check the oil one more up here. And oil is good. Everything else looks good. right, old Bessie. Give me another good day. Yesterday was Sunday, so all I did was come down here and dump this truck into the bin and then put some fuel on the truck there to take to the combine this morning. Well, I noticed when I pulled this truck out, power steering wasn't right. I've got a leak here somewhere that I've got to figure out on what's going on somewhere in this steering box. It's leaking and I gotta figure it out. So there's a spot there, and you can see a drip right there, and I haven't figured out where the heck it's coming from unless it's on the back side. I had this box rebuilt a couple of years ago, 3-4 years ago maybe. I think this seal here was leaking. So I see nothing there. I see nothing here on the hoses. Neither hose is leaking. So I don't know if there's something on the backside that is leaking. I haven't figured it out yet. So I've got some power steering fluid here. I'm gonna dump in there and see what I can see. As I said, it's gonna be a Monday. Damn it, it's my first time pouring power steering fluid, and I made a mess everywhere, so how the hell can I tell where the leak is when I'm spilling it all over the place? It doesn't make any sense on where it's coming from. Okay, I'm gonna pull this up to the shop where I can get some cardboard and roll under there and see if I can get a better look of where that oil might be coming from. Somewhere up on that side. And of course the leaf spring is here in the way. I can't see right up there on the side. All right, I gotta put you down and look at this closer. And so I've just wiped it down and you can see it's starting to drip down there. Well, this is gonna be a rainy day project, and unfortunately we don't have any rainy days for the next 5 days. So I think I'm just gonna have to keep putting power steering fluid in it and run it. Oh well, I got soybeans to cut, and we're not hauling these to the elevator at the moment, so we're only 2 miles from the farm, so we're gonna send it. They may be dry enough to cut, I don't know. I may have to wait. If that's the case on those darker ones, then I think I can finish what is ready down here today. I can definitely cut this field. So I've got 7, 13, I've got about between 15 and 20 acres that I know are ready down here on this farm. The last, what is that, about 6, 10 or 12 acres, I may have to wait a couple more days before we can cut them. someone asked me in a previous video, they were commenting at the clean sample of soybeans I had in the tank. I don't know how they could see with the dirty window, and damn it, I was going to clean that this morning, but I forgot to do that. Well, I haven't been real pleased with the sample in the tank. I've got a few little of the short sticks in there that I just can't get out. But having said that, I was watching a video a couple, maybe 2 weeks ago. Someone on one of those new John Deere $3 million X9 combines, and looking at the sample in the tank that he had behind him, it had a lot of pods in it, and he was pleased with that sample. If I had spent $5 million on a new combine and I had that many pods in the sample, I would be taking that machine back to whoever I bought it from and saying, there's something wrong with this machine. But yeah, you could see the pods in there, and he was pleased with the sample. My God, I don't have that many pods in my sample, but I do have a few sticks. And you have that fine line of where you get the bottom screen set, and if you have it closed down too tight, then it's putting too many beans back in the tailings return auger and putting those beans back in, and then it splits the beans. But to get it open enough for the beans to drop through, then you're going to get a few sticks in there. If you put the fan speed up too high, you're going to throw beans out. So I guess I just have to put up with a few sticks. So someone was asking me what settings I had my machine on. It's going to vary by soybean variety. This soybean variety right here, the pods, I don't see a lot of shattering in the field. And what I mean by that is, with the soybeans just sitting in the field, they will start to pop open, and the beans just fall right on the ground just sitting here in the field. I'm not noticing that with this variety. So you have to be a little bit more aggressive to open that pod up with the combine and get it out of there. I have seen varieties where they're falling out in the field just from the sun hitting them, and you can hear them popping in the field. Well, with a variety like that, it doesn't take a whole lot to open that pod up and get that bean out. And so you can slow your cylinder speed down, open your concave clearance up a little bit, and it's going to get that bean out with just blowing on it sometimes. So anyhow, what I've got right now is my concave is just a little bit more than a one. So you can see that there. And we'll start the machine up here, and I'll show you the other settings that I've got. So on my cylinder speed, I hope you can see that. Ooh, get in focus here. Anyway, that is on 460. And then my my fan speed is 1040, 1050. So cylinder speed 460, fan speed 1040. And concave setting on a little more than a one. And then I have this this gauge here for setting my sieve and my screens. And I think on my bottom screen, I had it at, I want to say, because of the size of my beans, I had it on this end, which is a quarter inch. I think I opened it up just a little bit more than a quarter inch, and that's on the bottom screen. So you should have a chart in your combine that kind of looks like this, that gives you somewhere to start. So soybean cylinder speed 300 plus, concave 6 and below, fan R 1000. And then the chaffer, the top one, 9/16. I don't have it open that wide. So the sieve, the bottom screen, they're saying 3/8. I have mine on a quarter. That's going to depend on the size of the soybean. I think the top, the chaffer, I think I set that on, I think I had that one on like a half an inch on the top one. So those are my settings. Your mileage may vary, your soybeans may vary, the price of your combine may vary. All right, let's get started here and get this dust rolling. Let's slow the reel down. We're definitely going too fast on that. The rock trap lately, and I think I just sent a rock through the combine, so I'm gonna go empty this rock trap now. This thing, I haven't emptied it since corn, so it's gonna have corn cobs in it. Oh man, hold on, I gotta put you down. I'm supposed to do this after I've blown the machine off. I got dust going everywhere in my eyes. We're not gonna lay in there, put those corn cobs in there. That's what was in the rock trap, corn cobs. All right, now let's go for it. Yesterday, while in my office doing my weekly paperwork and paying the bills, I did look for a new circuit board for the warning display panel up here. And so I did find a used one with, who did I get it from? I think it's Abilene Machine. Abilene Machine had a used one for $400. So that sounds like a fair price for a used one, providing that it works. So I have ordered that. It should be here on Wednesday. So fingers crossed that that is my issue and it is going to fix the problem. This is one of those fields with deer damage and stones. Don't get that stone, there you go. But along this tree line, they come out here, and it is nothing to see a half a dozen to a dozen of them here in the evening out in this field. And so you can see short beans. They don't want to feed into the header very nicely. Another stone on the header, so I've got to jump out of here again. But that's okay, I need exercise. Dumping some more, and they're still dusty. I made a pass across the end of this field with these beans that still have some green leaves on them. I'm gonna have to let them sit a couple more days. I've just got too many butter beans in the tank from them. So I'm going to cut the ones here that are dry. I've got, about 8 acres here or so of these dry ones. So that's what I'm going to cut. And we'll leave these others for, it's probably going to take them 3 to 5 days to dry out. There's just enough in them, enough green ones in them to ruin the sample. Let's see if we can see them in the tank. I may have put too many others. Ruin it, so we'll wait a couple days on those. Let's get out and look at the difference in these beans. I've never really come out here through the year while they were growing to see if there was any difference in them. All right, so they're a little bit later bean than these. These were all planted the same day. You can see the difference in the colors. All right, height of them right up to here, roughly. Yep, right up to there, and over here, maybe 2 inches taller, a couple inches taller on the height. And looking at the pod fill, 3 beans, 3 in there, 3 there. 2 in that one, 3 in that one. As far as shatter goes, they pop pretty easily. We do have one podworm damage there, but for the most part, they look pretty good. We don't have pods all the way to the bottom here. We come up about 5 or 6 inches before we get pods on these. 2 beans there. All right, let's walk over here to the ones I've been cutting. Look at that. 4 beans in that one. 4 beans in that one. Look at that. 2 in that one, 3, 2, 3, 3, two there. All right, and these, the beans go a little bit further down to the bottom, almost right at the bottom. And two beans in that one, none in that one. So not quite as good a fill on these. Not quite as tall. And because it was an earlier bean, maybe the weather didn't hit it just right, but I don't know. It would be nice to have a yield monitor here just to verify the difference in the two. The field isn't quite large enough that I can, well, I may be able to count rows, how many passes I make and how many beans go in the tank. So when I talk about the shattering, these pods will pop open by themselves. Certain varieties of beans, the pods will just pop open by themselves out here in the field and just drop the beans on the ground. And that is usually caused by the dew in the morning and the drying in the afternoon. So the dew will cause these beans to get a little larger, push that pod open, and then when they start to dry, the pod will just pop right open and put the beans on the ground. But I don't see any out here doing that. I have seen some years, certain varieties, up to half of these pods will shatter on their own and drop the beans on the ground. So that's why it's important to get out here and get these beans as soon as they're ready. Looks like deer damage here. Deer have come in and knocked that over. Yep, you can see it all through here where the deer have been out here. Look at this. And just had a field day out here knocking these beans over. All right, I'm not getting anything done standing out here talking to you, so let's get back on here and do it. I was just checking my notes on these two variety of soybeans. So this variety that I am cutting now is a group 3.9, and the variety over there is a group 4.4. So what that means is the maturity of it, how long it takes these beans to mature. So for instance, up on the Canadian border, let's say the Dakotas and Minnesota, those areas, they would plant a group 0 or a group 1, I believe. And then as you start moving south, you would get into your group 2s and group 3s. And then once you get down to the very south, like probably Mississippi, Alabama, that area, they're probably planting group 6s and or group 5s anyway. I don't know if there are group 6 beans, at least a group 5. Because they have longer growing degree days, a longer period for growing. So hopefully that makes a little bit of sense to you on the maturity of these soybeans. So they start out at group 0s, at least I think there's group 0s, and then go up to at least a group 5 and maybe a group 6. That I'm not sure about. But we are in an area here where group 3s, mid to late group 3s up until the mid to late group 4s do well for us. And I like to plant both 3s and 4s because it's going to depend on the weather some years on which ones do better. I've had very good success with 3s. Now the advantage of with these group 3s is you're able to get them off early enough to go ahead and plant some wheat, some winter wheat behind here. So that is my plan. I think I'm only gonna plant about 50 acres of winter wheat this year. But these are off early enough that I can do that. The optimum time for planting winter wheat in this area is October 14th to the 28th. That's kind of the fly-free dates. And today is October 14th, so I did say October, right, and not November. October 14th to the 28th. Today is October 14th, so we are in the optimal time for planting in winter wheat. So I did plant the ends of this field with the later soybeans, the group 4.4. And you can see there's a few green ones in there. This end is not as bad as the other end, but a few green ones right there. But I've got time, so we're just gonna leave these, or leave the rest of the field sit a couple more days. See, there's some green ones right there, some up here. I just got off the phone with my fertilizer slash chemical slash seed dealer and reserved 125 bags of seed wheat. So my game plan at the moment is to go ahead and load the truck over there. Well, I won't load it over there, I'll bring it down here and load it. And I think tomorrow morning I will take that load of soybeans to the elevator and then swing by the fertilizer place and pick up my seed wheat, bring it down the road, and maybe tomorrow afternoon I can start planting some wheat. I'm just going to no-till the wheat. I'm not going to work any ground up. That is the plan. At the moment, plans are always subject to change. Just a simple lunch today. Cheese and cheddar crackers. One of my favorites. Doesn't take much to keep me going. And some water. Not quite a full tank, but I've cut all that are ready. The truck is full, and the Birdman is bringing the wagon for me to dump this tumble on. I'm gonna go grab the blower while I'm waiting for him so I can blow this machine off. I didn't get all of this on the wagon, so we had to turn the truck around and shake the truck a little bit. I've got it all on there, but man, it's a lot. But the tank is empty, so I'm gonna have to drive that home to shake it down in order to get the tarp on it. And the Birdman is taking the wagon home, and we're just gonna dump that in the bin. All right, not a bad day. I had to get off the combine a couple of times for stones on the header, but I've only cut about 20 acres today. It's 4 o'clock. No, it's 4:30. I have the combine blowed off, headed home, unloading the wagon and a few odd jobs around the farm, but that's gonna end this video. So I'm gonna say, see ya.
See ya.